Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 11th December 2018. Today we will be discussing four topics for prelims. The first one is related with extradition of Vijay Mallya to India. The second is related with the case filed against land acquisition law. The third is related about fixed drug combination for tuberculosis. The last one is about resignation of RBI Governor Urjit Patel. Let's move to the first article. This news item is related with extradition of Vijay Mallya to India. Judicial procedures undertaken to arrest any violators of law changes from country to country. And many of the criminals, especially the economic offenders, they move to a particular area where the laws are weak so that they can avoid getting arrested in their home country. One fine example is Vijay Mallya. He has an unpaid due over 9,000 crores to Indian banks. And he has been declared as willful defaulter. Whenever a criminal is being arrested in India, we normally get to see the terms like arrest or detention. Whereas, when a criminal is brought from a different country, we get to see the terms like extradition and deportation. Deportation is not a judicial process, whereas extradition is a judicial process. So what is extradition? Extradition is a process by which a governmental authority formally turns over an alleged criminal to another governmental authority. In Vijay Mallya's case, it is the UK government handing over to Indian government. This is the basic difference between extradition and deportation. Under the code of international law, there has been a consensus that no country doesn't have any obligation to surrender an alleged criminal. This is because every country has their own sovereignty, and with their sovereignty, they have their own legal authority to adjudicate the crimes in their land. And because of this principle of sovereignty, extradition of Vijay Mallya took more than 4 years. Since extradition is a communication between two governmental authorities, extradition treaties have been signed between different nations. India has signed extradition treaties with UK, and recently in the case of Christian Michael, accused in Augusta Westland helicopter scam, he was extradited to India because of India's extradition treaty with UAE. So, whenever we try to extradite a person from a different country, the basic requirement is an extradition treaty between India and the other country. So, what is the procedure for extradition in India? In order to initiate any extradition process, first, a red notice should be issued by International Criminal Police Organization, which is popularly known as Interpol. And with this red notices, these red notices are issued by the General Secretariat of Interpol, which is located in Lyon, France. This red notice is distributed to different state police authorities and immigration authorities. As far as India is concerned, CBI is the nodal authority for Interpol in India. In order to undertake the process of extradition judiciously, India has enacted an act, Indian Extradition Act 1962. Of that act, section 34B has provision about arrest and extradition of fugitive criminals from India. And this request for extradition will be undertaken only if it is coming from diplomatic channels. This successful extradition of Vijay Mallya from United Kingdom indicates the successful diplomatic relationship between India and UK. The next article is about a petition filed by activist Medha Patkar against the amendments introduced by several state governments to the land acquisition law. For that, we have to know the basics of Land Acquisition Act 2013. The Land Acquisition Act 2013 is an act of Indian Parliament with the aim of laying down procedures and rules to ensure compensation, rehabilitation, and relief for land owners. According to Indian Constitution, land falls under state list, whereas land acquisition falls under concurrent list. So, the several states including Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Jharkhand, they introduced new amendments to facilitate land acquisition in their states. What was that amendment? These amendments allow authorities to bypass the need to take farmers' consent before acquiring their lands for large infrastructural projects. These amendments have raised some concerns among the farmers and civil society activists. What are those concerns? Any infrastructural development project will start only after completion of social impact assessment studies. And this social impact assessment studies should have representations from local representative bodies like Gram Sabha. These amendments have led to a situation where the Gram Sabha members are not allowed to participate in the social impact assessment studies. Apart from this lack of participatory social impact assessment studies, the expert appraisal processes are also not happening in a positive manner. These amendments also violate the core spirit of the Land Acquisition Act 2013. The Act mandates that 70% of the affected landowners should have provided consent for initiating any public-private participation project. This provision was provided in order to uphold the farmers' right to dignity and life. The government is paying the money to the farmers in order to acquire their lands. This taxpayers' money used to acquire land and create infrastructure is being taken by the private players who are focusing only on profit making and not on social development. So these are the concerns related with the amendments introduced by various state governments to the Land Acquisition Act. The next article is about the combination drugs not being approved by regulator. A recent study indicates that out of 110 anti-TB fixed dose combinations, only 32 has been approved by CDSCO. And the fixed dose combinations also applicable to malaria, and of them, only 8 out of 20 FDCs have been approved. This shows a grim picture of pharmacovigilance in India. First, we have to know what is a fixed drug combination. Fixed dose combination is a combination product of more than one active pharmaceutical ingredient in a fixed ratio of doses formulated into a single dosage in order to form a capsule or tablet. And this FDC becomes more important in larger health problems like TB. Though TB affects mainly the lungs of an individual, it has effects on different parts of the body. In order to cut down those effects and to rehabilitate the patient, different drugs are needed. Most of the TB patients fall in socially and economically underprivileged group, and they lack knowledge, they lack awareness about consuming different doses of drugs at different time. In order to enable the patients to complete their course of prescription, fixed dose combination becomes more important. As we discussed earlier, the pharmacovigilance mechanism in India is in very weak state. Apart from this functional problems, there are also some structural problems like understaffing, lack of skills among the health workers, and inadequate infrastructure for health centers. These problems has to be understood and worked upon in order to improve the state of drugs being supplied to the patients. The next article is about the resignation of RBI Governor Urjit Patel. Before getting to know about the events that led to resignation of RBI governor, we should know the basics about RBI. RBI, the Central Bank of India. With the mandate of regulating monetary inflation controlling, minting functions. RBI was established in the year 1935 under RBI Act. The Act has provided for the provision of a post of governor, and the governor is assisted by four deputy governors and a board, RBI board, comprising 20 members. There are ex officio members from RBI and directors appointed by central government. This is the basic about RBI. And the resignation of Urjit Patel is not the first instance in RBI's history. So far, 5 RBI governors have resigned in middle of their term. Of them, one governor, he resigned in 1937. So after independence, 4 RBI governors have resigned. Since RBI has many important functions to perform in India's financial sector, the post of governor cannot be left vacant. Whenever the post of governor is left vacant by death or resignation of a governor, the next senior most deputy governor will function as a temporary governor. This is the basics about RBI and the functions of a governor. Let's see the events that led to the resignation of RBI governor. We have witnessed the ongoing tussle between RBI and central government. These tussles were initiated by various irritants. The first one was related with invocation of Section 7 of RBI Act. The second is related with the liquidity crisis in NBFCs. The third was related with the stringent prompt corrective action framework. And the last and the most important one was related with sharing of reserves, the sharing of RBI's contingent reserve with the central government. These irritants caused a serious misunderstanding between RBI and central government. These problems led to volatility in financial market, this volatility led to reduced confidence among investors, and a near crisis-like situation. In India's financial market, these events led to the resignation of RBI governor. Now let's move to the topics related to the mains. The first article is about the precarious state of Indian farmers. The second article is related with the tussle between the ideals of power and democracy in Indian society. The third is related with the violation of human rights in TB treatment. The fourth is related with the arguments made in favor of GMO, that is genetically modified organisms. The first article is titled as The Shackled Indian Farmer. This has been taken from the newspaper Mint. In this article, the author speaks about how the intervention of government has reduced the individual agency of farmers to improve their livelihood. There has been increased governmental interference in agriculture. The first and the major interference by the government is through the Agriculture Produce Market Company, APMCs. Under the APMC Act, the country has been divided into different geographical units which act as an individual market. And a farmer located in that geographical unit can sell the goods only to that particular APMC mandi. This reduces the competence for high prices, reduces competition. Monopoly of any kind, be it state monopoly or private monopoly, does not augur well in a market economy. This APMC monopoly has led to the re-emergence of license raj. This mandi licenses and APMC mechanism has led to the breeding of political patronage. And this politicization and cartelization of APMCs has further down the cost of farmers. Apart from the structural problems in APMC, there is also a wide gap between the farm price and market price. the price at which the good is procured from farmer is way lower than what is being paid by an end consumer. This gap has potential to create inflationary situation for the end consumers and a deprived income level for the farmers. The author says that MSP has been impoverishing farmers and consumers for decades by widening the gap between the farm price and market price. One of the possible way for farmers to improve their income is by undertaking futures trading in agriculture. But the heavy regulatory mechanism or near prohibitory mechanism in India has restricted the spread of futures trading in agriculture. Also, the various land being a state subject, various land classification processes followed by the state governments have ensured that the agricultural land of a farmer cannot be sold to non-farmers, has ensured that the farmers are not allowed to sell their land to non-farmers, and even they cannot change the usage of their land. This has limited and depressed the viability of using an agricultural land as an economic commodity. Next important problem being faced by the Indian farmer is lack of institutional credit. The government schemes or other initiatives taken by the government to improve the financial position of a farmer are always provided through state-owned banks or cooperative banks. This lack of financial help from financial assistance from the state-owned entities, the farmers are looking towards the informal credit, which is pushing them into a debt trap. The agriculture per se should be seen as a tool to improve the economy of the rural households, but whereas and the politicians use agriculture to maximize their political career, and they use it as a political tool by providing subsidies, and the subsidies reduce the value of a good being produced. Since the farmer is not aware of the value of electricity they are using, since it is being provided freely, he overuses electricity. And since water considered to be a public commodity and it is available freely, they are overusing water. This leads to various socio-economic problems. The Essential Commodities Act governs that, mentions that any of the farm inputs like seed, fertilizers, they cannot be brought in open market setting. It follows a regulated market settings, thereby preventing the farmers to buy a good of better choice. This has reduced the quality of farm inputs. The other major impedance lying in front of the Indian farmers is in lack of viable and alternative technologies to improve their agricultural produce. The various factors which we discussed earlier has reduced the agency of a farmer. The farmer is continuing to play a role of an actor in a script directed by the state, whereas the farmer should have their own agency, own decision-making authority, which would lead to improved infusion of technology in agriculture. But the farmer is always looking for a state-ordained green revolution in order to make use of technology in their economic activity. Also, the heavy regulatory mechanisms has led to a situation where the experimentations, whatever being the experimentation done in farmland, is done illegally. One example is illegal planting of BT brinjal. The field trials of BT brinjal is banned in India, but the seeds are smuggled from Bangladesh and is being sown in India. Also, the fragmentation of land and subsistence agriculture has led to a condition where the farming is conducted in India without much technology or insurance. This makes agriculture a most difficult job in India. The reforms undertaken to make India join the bandwagon of globalization, post-1991 reforms undertaken in India, has made India into one market for global goods. All the problems we discussed earlier have not allowed the farmers to use all their resources judiciously in order to engage with global markets in an effective manner. The government should embark on a long-term policy planning measure in order to address the woes being faced by the Indian farmers so that the Indian farmers prosper. The prosperity of a primary economic activity is the base for a country's economic growth and development. The next article is titled Ascent to the Temple of Democracy. In this article, the author discusses between the conflicting ideologies of power and democracy. the power and democracy are interdependent. Power in any society, power in general, can originate from different sources. Whereas democracy should and must only originate from people. In a democratic society, the power originates from people. This basic difference between the power and democracy has been explained in this article through the societal conditions in Kerala in the wake of Sabarimala protest. The author calls Kerala as a paradox of prosperity. This is because Kerala was considered to be one of the impoverished states in India. But with the social initiatives undertaken by the subsequent governments, it has become the state in India with high human development. This has made the author to call as a paradox of prosperity. Power in an undemocratic society, undemocratic setup, originates from social hierarchy. And this originates from the feudal, this originates from feudalism. The abolishment of feudal orders in post-independent Kerala has led to the abolishment of social hierarchy, and this way the power was originating from democratic setup in Kerala. This is the condition of Kerala as explained by the author. Let's see how a power is being defined under Marxian perspective. The Marxian perspective says that economic structure is the base for any social structures. But this economy related analysis of power, Michel Foucault, a French philosopher, he says that power is ubiquitous. Power is ubiquitous and it ramifies its presence in any human association. So these are the perspectives offered by different philosophers while explaining the concept of power. So considering these definitions of power, if we get to analyze the recent happenings in Kerala, that is the Sabarimala crisis, Sabarimala protest, which is the outcome of patriarchal power. The patriarchal power arises from the heteronormativity. Heteronormativity is belief in gender roles based on heteronormativity and ethnic ascribed markers. That is the identities attained by an individual during his or her birth. This heteronormativity and ethnic or ascribed markers has led to the origin of patriarchal power. And the recent protests in Sabarimala for allowing the women between 10 and 50 years into Sabarimala shrine is the outcome of the patriarchal power that has gained its foothold in the state for the past decades. Democracy is not only enjoying one's own right. Democracy is about enjoying own and respecting others' rights. Also, democracy creates a public perception about inevitability of change in a society. So, the improper distribution of power in a democratic society has led to concentration of power, based on social norms. And this concentration of power is augmented by religion. Right to religion in a democracy is offered by democratic system existing in a country. For example, when communists were ruling in Soviet Russia, the churches were closed. And in communist China, the Uyghurs are facing discrimination. So, in a democratic system, the right to worship or the right to follow a particular religion is offered by the democracy itself. So, the religion in a democracy should act in a bounded manner to the ideals of constitution. By allowing religions to act independent of constitution would lead to proliferation of republics within Republic of India. This improper skewed distribution of heteronormativity induced patriarchal power originates from the lack of women agency, lack of agency among women. This is created by male chauvinism. Democracy is nothing but distribution of powers. Democracy is distribution of power. Empowerment of women is needed Empowerment of women is the only way forward to reduce this skewed distribution of power, which is undemocratic. Let's move to the next article. The next article is about the violation of human rights while undertaking treatments or providing new technology innovation measures to treat TB patients. TB is one of the most killing diseases in the world. It kills more than 2 million people per year in the global south. Tuberculosis is caused by the Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacteria. It is a chronic necrotizing disease caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and this disease is curable and preventable, but it needs intervention in right time and continued treatment. There are two types of tuberculosis. The one is pulmonary TB, the other is extrapulmonary TB. The pulmonary TB accounts for 80% of all TB cases, and extrapulmonary TB accounts for 20% of all TB cases. Various government and international groups like United Nations have been acting against the spread of TB. United Nations in September 2018, in a declaration titled "United to End Tuberculosis, an Urgent Global Response to a Global Epidemic," reaffirmed the commitment to end the global TB by 2030. So in this paper, they have discussed about introducing many technology-infused coercion methods. One such technological method being planned by India is to implant microchips in TB patients in order to track them and to ensure that they complete TB treatment. Also, the directly observed treatment short course strategy, that is DOT strategy, followed by India to treat TB patients requires the patients to report every day to a health authority. This violates the individual autonomy and agency of a human. This obsession with new gadgets in disease management has created few concerns. And what is the major concern? The first one is that this disease can be eliminated in an inexpensive way just by human-based interventions. The recent initiatives are considering the TB patients as subjects to be controlled by an device, but not as a human who should be treated with health systems that foster trust, partnership, and dignity. The response to treat TB should not be rooted in control and coercion, rather, it should be with human touch. In order to address these major grievances, Pro Athara suggested some interventions. The bedaquiline and delaminid, which are the new TB drugs, which has potential even to cure the MDR-TB, multi-drug-resistant TB, to be introduced to be made easily available for the patients. One of the important impediments in eradicating TB is the lack of skilled health workers. So, in order to increase the human touch in TB treatment, the community healthcare workers should be equipped with proper training and dignified conditions of employment so that they would lead the response by bringing care to those people who are away from the reach of the treatment. In order to improve accountability in the process of eradicating TB, community-based structures such as clinic committees and grassroots civil society-based partnership trust initiatives should be taken. This accountability would improve the quality of health care being provided to the TB patients. The way ahead for the governments and organizations is that the people with TB not need to be watched, whereas they need to be heard. The grievances of the TB patients has to be heard. Every individual, be it a person with chronic disease like TB or a healthy person, they all have their inherent right to not to be disturbed, because the privacy includes the right of not being disturbed. And they have their individual autonomy, they have their individual dignity. Using them as an object controlled by a gadget violates their basic virtue of human dignity. The state should take measures that improve dignity of the patients by introducing more skilled labor forces who in turn will improve the human touch in the treatment process. The next article is titled "Don't Believe the Anti-GMO Campaign." This comes as a response to an article authored by M.S. Swaminathan few days back. In that article, M.S. Swaminathan and Mr. P.C. Kesavan had suggested that GM crops are not sustainable in Indian scenario. They have cited the natural and evolutionary reasons and the technology, the recombinant DNA technology used in developing GM crops, the cost of GE seeds, and lack of awareness about unintended effects, absence of rigorous biosafety protocols, the failure of BT cotton in India, socio-economic cost of the farmers, and the reappearances of pests in BT cotton as a reasons to argue that GM crops are not sustainable in India. In this article, the author has given his argument countering the claims of M.S. Swaminathan. The first is the point of abiotic stress. Abiotic stress in a crop is caused by abiotic factors like drought, flood, lack of proper irrigation facilities, and other physical infrastructures. GM crops are mainly designed in such a way to withstand the abiotic stress. But this factor was countered by M.S. Swaminathan in his paper that this GM crops does not consider about the biotic stress that could arise out of using GM crops. The author in this article counters the statement of M.S. Swaminathan by saying that abiotic stress is one of the major problems faced by farming community. So, genetically modified crops has an important role to play in countering the abiotic stress, says the author. The second argument is based on reduced input cost. GM technology adoption has reduced pesticide use by 37% and increased crop yield by 22%. These two in turn had led to the increased profit of 68%. The author cites scientific findings. The author also argues that GM crops are not carcinogenic based on researches undertaken by various science academies. The author cites the example of BT cotton in improving production. Before introduction of BT cotton, the average production in India was 300 kg per hectare. After introduction of BT cotton, the production was around 500 kg per hectare. This has made India a cotton exporting country. Reappearance of new pests in BT cotton. Reappearance of new pests in BT cotton is one of the reasons said by M.S. Swaminathan to cite GM crops to be unsustainable. The author in this article says that the appearance of new pests is a factor of the tropical climate, and he suggests the use of integrated pest management practices to curtail the menace of pests. Another major argument against GM crops is the usage of glyphosate. Glyphosate is a weedicide that can be used in GM mustard in order to clear the weeds in the field. The glyphosate has been suspected to reduce the biodiversity of the cropland by killing even the most supporting life forms. The author has argued for using glyphosate by saying that the introduction of glyphosate in GM mustard is now only being undertaken in experimental manner and it is not being implemented in fields. The next point is about the BT brinjal. The Government of India, through its Genetic Engineering Advisory Committee, has prohibited BT brinjal in India. But the same BT brinjal of Monsanto is being planted in Bangladesh without any negative effects successfully. The author also says that India's genetic engineering protocols are one of the toughest in the world. And a government has the power to cut down the harmful genetic technologies. The author has concluded by saying that in order to improve the food crop productivity, in order to reduce the input cost, in order to improve the food security of the nation, and to improve the income of farmers, GM crops are more important and they are sustainable in the long term.